Hey everybody, this is Tracy here for another edition of A View from Tracy's Point, and we are here to recap the Quad Season 1, and it was the season finale, which was titled The Caged Bird. And if you follow my recaps and you watch the one from last week, it was also called The Caged Bird because I messed up on the title. So I did go back and correct it. And last week's episode was actually called Their Eyes Were Watching God. So let's go ahead and get started. So the show opens with Eva and she was having a really bad dream, but it was like one of those insecurity dreams where everything is like weighing down on you and you don't know who to trust. So she's in her office and it has been turned into a strip club. So in the middle of the office, she has like a stage with a stripper pole, and she is dressed in like some, you know, scantily lingerie, lace lingerie that says Gam U. And then sitting around the room is Jason, Derek, Pettigrew. I can't remember who this lady was, but I think she's on the board of directors. And then there were a couple of white guys and some other people that I don't remember, you know, being introduced on the show. But I'm thinking that they probably were like the auditors from the group that Mr. Briggs had pulled together who want to invest in the college. And then maybe some of the board of directors from GAMU itself. And so, you know, she, I don't know if that was Eva or a body double up there, but whoever it was, they had a very nice toned body and they were working that pole. So I'm thinking it may have been Eva herself, but anyway, she was doing the thing, but thank God she woke up and realized that it was all a dream. So Noni goes into Diamond's office and she is surprised that he was there and back to work. And so I was kind of confused as to why she went into the office if she didn't know that he was back. And so she tells him that while he was in the hospital that she was there, and he lets her know that even though he was unconscious, that the conscious mind can feel the presence and the spirit of other people. So he knew that she was there. So, you know, she's brown nosing again, and that made her feel good that he knew that she was there praying for him. So after class, Cedric is approached by a female student who asks him if he would be interested in tutoring at a local elementary school for at-risk kids. Let's stick a pin. So the girl, I never call her name. It was like Brooke or Britt or something like that. But anyway, she is the daughter. Remember when the game came back on BET and they had then changed that, the Brit Brat, you know, Jason and, the white woman, Kelly. And they had changed out Jason and Kelly's daughter to this other girl that was just like off the chain. Okay, so she was playing this character on the Quad last night. And I can't remember if she was a teacher, because at first I thought she said she volunteered at this school. But then when they had a scene at the school, it was more like she was the actual teacher in the classroom. So not really sure what was going on, but the bottom line is she thought that Cedric would make a good tutor at the school and that he could relate to some of the kids in the classroom. And she was approaching him because she found out that he had made an A on his math exam, and she, you know, said that she thought he'd be a good fit. So Cedric, you know, at first he says that, you know, he doesn't know why she thought that he would be able to work with at-risk kids. I guess he kind of like took it personal, like she was saying that he came, you know, from an at-risk environment. But he decides to go over to the school and check it out. And so when he gets there, you know, she's talking to the kids and everything. But the kids are being very disrespectful. And I think a couple of them dropped a few curse words in there. So Cedric, you know, being from the hood, he jacked up one of the little boys. And so the girl is like, oh my God, you can't do that. You know, get your hands off of that student. And so she's kind of like reprimanding Cedric in front of the kids. And she's asking Cedric, like, does he have any common sense? Like, what would make him think that it was okay to treat the children that way? And so he's looking at her like, do you have any common sense that you think it's okay to reprimand me for taking up for you when you got these little badass kids in this classroom just running amok and taking over you? So that situation didn't end very well. Then we move over to the locker room, and Terrence has called a meeting with all the football players. And so he's trying to, you know, extend the love and let the guys know that they're still a team. They have this homecoming game coming up. You know, they're undefeated. So he wants them to pull together and, you know, work together as a team. But then one of the players, you know, he stands back and says, well, you know, how can we be a team when you're out here being accused of raping people? And then slowly the rest of the team kind of turns against Terrence. And they're like, yeah, you know, he has a point that since all of these allegations have taken place, you're supposed to be the team captain, but yet you haven't thought enough of us to come back to us and give your version of the story or to reassure us that you didn't do what you're being accused of doing. And so a scuffle erupts and Coach Hartwick has to come out and intervene and break everything up. So you can kind of feel the tide turning against Terrence. So at the homecoming banquet, Eva gets up and she kind of like does a welcome or an introduction, and she's introducing Coach Hartwick to come up and lead them in prayer before dinner is served. But then Terrence, for some reason, decided that this would be a perfect moment for him to address his teammates since they, you know, accused him of not doing so earlier. So he's giving a speech about how GAMU has changed his life, and you know, he's grateful for the opportunity to be there and to be a leader and all this good stuff. And so everybody's looking at him like, okay, dude, you know, he gets a little warm round of applause. And then Coach Hartwick gets up to lead the prayer, but before he can get a word out, Sydney, Madison, Trina, and then a group of other girls, they march into the room and they're screaming, yelling, I did not consent. You know, first it starts out one by one, I did not consent. And then the room just fills up with all these other girls and they have on like these matching t-shirts. So they totally, you know, disrupt the banquet. But then the police come in and they, you know, escort the girls out and try and get control back in the room. But by then, Terrence had run out of the room, and then Coach Hartwick is just standing there looking totally disgusted by the whole display. So I don't know if he was disgusted at Terrence or if he was disgusted at Eva or if he was disgusted at Sydney and the rest of the girls for disrupting the banquet. So afterwards, you know, there's a media storm. So you have a group of reporters that's interviewing Eva, and then you have a group that were interviewing another lady who, like I said, they were introducing some people and I wasn't catching names on this show, if they were even giving the names, because I thought the school attorney was a really light-skinned black woman, but the lady that was at the press conference, she was actually a white woman. So I don't know if she represented the school or if she was like maybe the district attorney or the prosecutor in the city. It wasn't clear who she was. At the press conference with Eva, they were asking her, you know, did she know that the protest was going to take place? Did she sanction the protest? And so she's standing there like smiling and gloating about the whole situation, but she's denying that she knew anything about it. And then when we move over to the other lady, and she has a whole lot more press in the room with her, and she's basically saying that Eva was showing favoritism, that she liked judgment, and she put GAMU in a precarious situation by allowing the protest to take place. And then she was saying that when Cedric was arrested for killing Chantal, you know, Eva was all on his side, saying how the university was going to stand by Cedric and that he was innocent until proven guilty. But with Terrence, she's basically crucifying him and, you know, giving out this public cry that he's guilty and needs to be prosecuted. And so she was just, you know, showing how Eva was being really unfair and judgmental. And then we go back over to Eva's press conference, and then Sydney and the other, Madison and Trina, they're sitting at the table. And so Sydney is just basically coming out saying that, you know, they did the protest because Terrence was guilty and that her and the other girl had gone to the police department and filed a complaint because he had raped her too. And so she was just like smearing him in the media. And I'm thinking, if that happened anywhere else, they would be facing a libel lawsuit, but it is television, so we're going to give them a pass. Then we have a scene where Noni goes to Cedric's room and Ebony is there. And so she says that she knew that Ebony, you know, comes to visit Cedric all the time. And so she was hoping that she would be there. And so Noni wants to explain why she, you know, has the spot in the band, because Ebony, you know, was calling her a thief and a traitor and a backstabber and saying that, you know, she set her up to get her place in the band, which is not really true, Ebony, because Noni only got the spot on the band after the hazing incident, but Ebony was kind of like saying it as though Noni was a part of the hazing and it was to get her out of the band. So Noni says that all her life, you know, she was the girl who was always left out, that nobody liked her because she was different, and that she actually had to change schools because she was bullied so bad. And then she tells Ebony that even her mom would always treat her as if she was the reason that people were bullying her. Not that, you know, people were just mean-spirited, but that it must have been something she was doing that was causing the bullying. So Ebony doesn't, you know, care, and she still blames Noni for what happened to her. But then Noni says that she wasn't betraying Ebony when she took the seat on the, took her spot in the band, that she was actually plotting revenge on Ebony's behalf by being in it. And so then Ebony's totally confused, and I was a little confused at that point too. But then she explains how she knew that Danny, something about Danny and the sheet music, and that she took pictures of the sheet music that Danny uses, you know, when he's practicing. And so she admits that she gave the sheet music to the Clive guy over at the other school, the Southwestern Delta School. And so Ebony, you know, points out to Noni that in the process of hurting Danny and getting Danny in trouble, that she actually hurt Mr. Diamond more. But Ebony, you know, Ebony gets it, but Noni didn't get it. And then I think there was a point where Ebony realized that Noni's so far damn gone that nothing she said would make her see any wrong in what she did. And so the two end up embracing, but Ebony still has this look on her face like, this damn girl is cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs. Eva finally lets Jason out again. I don't know where Jason has been, because remember the last time we saw him was the night of the president's fundraiser. And Eva had left him upstairs in the bedroom. So he's back. And, you know, the two have had, you know, mad crazy sex again. So Jason, you know, he asks her, you know, to share with him and let him know what's going on in her life. And that, you know, he wants to be a part of her life and more involved. And so Eva's looking at him like, boy, listen, I need one thing from you and one thing only. But then she decides, you know, to like prove a point to him that he's not ready to be a part, you know, in the grown-up life. So she shares with him that there's been four presidents in like the recent year or years prior to her, and that they were all fired because they couldn't get the fiscal, you know, the financials together, and that she doesn't want to be the fifth person to get fired. And so she tells him about Mr. Briggs and how, you know, he brought together this investment team and they're doing the audit, and that hopefully they'll pass so that they can get this money. So Jason tells her in a very immature way that the only reason Briggs is trying to help is because he wants to get her into bed. And so Eva tells him that his response was exactly what she expected. So she feels that he's too immature to be on her level intellectually and will only be good for sex. So when Eva leaves the room to go take a shower and get dressed, Jason picks up her phone, because the whole conversation started when she received a text message. And so he picks up the phone and he looks at the text message, and it was from Derek, and he's talking about the divorce. In the next scene, Eva goes to see Pettigrew and tells him that the auditors found a pattern of misappropriated funds, and she believes he is doing something with the money. And so Pettigrew seems really unbothered and tells Eva that he knows that Briggs is behind the audit, and that she should know that he has a really bad history with the school, and, you know, it's not going to reflect good on her when people find out that he's the one that is bringing the money in. So Eva tells him that if he tries anything, that she will have the auditors keep digging and digging and digging until they're able to trace back to whatever it is that he's doing with these funds that, you know, this account that he's set up. So then Danny goes to visit Mr. Diamond to beg for his spot on the band back. And Diamond, you know, won't budge and tells him that even if he didn't give the music away to the Clive guy, that he was careless and allowed someone else to steal the music. So he's still culpable for what happened and that he's still going to hold him responsible. And so Danny, you know, is basically saying that this is my life and he loves the band and that he actually could have graduated the year before, but he didn't because he wanted to come back and lead the band one more year. And so he, you know, realizes that Diamond isn't trying to change his mind. So Danny tells him that he's obviously never lost anything that he really loved. And then Diamond says that, you know, he knows all about loss. And Danny says, obviously, you haven't lost the right thing yet. So that was a real, you know, kind of deep moment. And I don't know why Diamond is being so hard on Danny because he has no proof that Danny gave the music to the Clive man. And even, and like, I understand the part about, you know, he was responsible for the music, but it's like Diamond doesn't even want to consider that somebody else, you know, could have given the music away. Even when Danny suggested that it was Noni, he still didn't want to hear what Danny had to say and was putting the full blame on him. Terrence goes to see Coach Hardwick, and Taisha is leaving his office. So, you know, they exchange looks because remember, they used to have something going on. And the coach is now starting to believe that Terrence may be guilty. So then he asks Terrence, did he ask Sydney if it was okay for them to have sex? And then Terrence was looking at him like, bro, are you crazy? Like, you don't ask a girl if you can kiss her. And that's probably true. I mean, I understand the whole you need consent thing, but let's be realistic. How many people actually sit down and have a conversation and say, okay, like, are you sure that you want to have sex with me? Like, that whole concept to me is just so far-fetched and so stupid in the full scheme of things. Like, in the real world, when in the real world, people wouldn't even be having sex outside of marriage. The coach reminds him that he knows that there were other girls and that, you know, he has jeopardized 80 other students trying to support Terrence. And then they get into like a little back and forth, and he kicks Terrence off the team and tells him that he doesn't care what he does. And I thought that, you know, his whole response to Terrence at that point was a bit harsh, especially since he acted like he was going to support him. And supporting a person to me is even if he believed that Terrence was guilty, like he still could have supported him and talked to him and tried to get him to admit what he did. And maybe, you know, he had helped him get a lawyer, like go with him and say, hey, you know, admit what you did and try to work things out, get a plea bargain, you know, try to apologize. Like, don't just be rude and nasty to the boy and just kick him to the curb like he's nothing. And so that was kind of messed up, I thought. So then we move over to Taisha Jr. and Bojan, and they are having a celebration because they won homecoming. And, you know, Bojan started and played the whole football game because, you know, Terrence was kicked off the team. And so the two of them, I think Junior asked Taisha if she was raped by Terrence or if she ever had a situation with Terrence, but Taisha shut that down real quick and that was over and done with. And then they got on a conversation about Bojan's dad, and they were kind of like, you know, indicating that the father was racist, but Bojan was pretty much shutting that down and saying that, you know, regardless of what he does or how he acts, he's still my father and I still, you know, have to respect him. And Jason shows up at Eva's and he's in a really good mood. And this damn scene was so funny. It just really showed how childish. Like, I'm thinking Jason is probably like 25, 26 years old because he's in the doctorate program, but he is a little simple-minded, or Eva just got him pussy whooped, one or the other. So Eva wants to go to the bedroom, but Jason wants to talk to her about her divorce and them being together. So, you know, he admits that he read the text from Derek. And so she's looking at him like, boy, like, are you for real? And then this fool gets down on his knee and he proposes to Eva. And he just really doesn't understand that all he is a boy toy for Eva. But Jason thinks that she doesn't want him because Mr. Briggs is moving in on his territory and she's all about the money. And so he breaks it off with Eva and tells her that she is going to get what she deserves for betraying him. So I guess Jason gonna be cutting up and acting a damn fool in season two. So in another scene earlier in the show, Cedric went back to the school to talk to Brit Brat and to apologize to her for the way that he responded to the kids in the classroom. And so she was kind of like looking at him like, yeah, you do owe an apology. But then after he finished, he was looking at her and she was like, what? And so basically he was thinking to himself, okay, damn, I apologize to you. You're not going to apologize for the way you talk to me. But she wasn't like, that was nowhere on her radar. So then he looked at her and was basically saying, if you don't know what, then nothing and I'm out of here. So then we come to a scene where she shows up at his dorm room and lets Cedric know that she has wanted to kiss him ever since he helped her at the school. And I'm just like, okay, that's what we doing. And so I guess that's her way of apologizing, like, too prideful to come out and say she was wrong, but maybe if I give you some coochie, then that will make everything better. So it was a good thing that Bryce was out hunting with his brothers, because Cedric just got all up in that. And it was to a point where she was, I guess they was trying to make a point about the whole consent thing, because he did ask her, like he was kissing on her and everything and about to go down. And then she kind of like, you know, held him up, and then he asked her, you know, if it was okay. But when she paused, I thought she was about to tell him that she was a transgender or something, because the scene was just so damn awkward. And then a couple of people was thinking that maybe she was a virgin and that was the reason she was acting that way. But then after I thought about it, I think they were just trying to do the whole get consent before you go forward in a sexual relationship. The last scene of the show, all the students are gathering in the quad and they're getting ready to celebrate homecoming when all of a sudden you hear shots fired. And then the police arrive and they go into this dorm room and somebody's saying that there was a guy who had a gun or something. And when they run up the stairs, there is a body. And then the police are radioing in saying that they have a man down and there's a gun and it looks like an apparent suicide. And then the camera scans in on the face and it is Terrence. And then you can hear one of the police, I don't know if it was a police officer or a security officer, but he was saying that it looks like the quarterback of the football team. Now, you guys let me know what you thought about the finale in the comments below, but I wasn't impressed with the finale. I thought it was very weak. I thought it was kind of thrown together, that they were trying to do too much. And I thought the whole suicide thing with Terrence was totally unnecessary. But then somebody pointed out on Twitter that maybe next season is going to come out that Sydney had lied and he really didn't rape her, that it was consensual. And so that's going to like add to the tension. And I don't know, but I just thought it was unnecessary. I think on a scale of 1 to 10, I would probably give the finale a 5. Yeah, I think I'll probably give it a 5. So you guys let me know what you thought, and let's get the conversation started. Rate the video, subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so already. And until next season, please go to youtube.com/aviewfromtracyspoint and check out all the other recaps that I do. So take care and have a great weekend.